Anatomical position is a stance in which a person stands erect with the feet flat on the floor, arms at the sides, and the palms and face facing forward. This position provides a precise and standard reference for anatomical description and dissection. So, unless stated otherwise in the text, we should always assume that all anatomical descriptions refer to this anatomical position, regardless of the actual subject's position during the examination. It is important to note and to learn to acknowledge this fact during medical examination, that if a person is facing you in anatomical position, their left will be on your right, and vice versa. The same is true for most anatomical illustrations that show organs in anterior view. The position of the forearm is particularly important in the description of the upper limb anatomy and movements. In the anatomical position, the palms, as we said, face forward or up if the elbow is flexed. And the forearm is said to be supine. In the opposite position, when the palm faces posteriorly or down, the forearm is pronated. This movement is important in the description of the anatomy of the upper limb and the forearm in particular, as in the supine position, the two forearm bones, radius and ulna, are parallel, and the radius is lateral to the ulna. The ulna is medial to the radius. During pronation, the radius and ulna cross, as the radius rotates around ulna at the distal end. The radius remains lateral to the ulna proximally at the elbow, but results medial to it distally at the wrist. In topographic anatomy, all the descriptions of muscles, nerves, and vessels in the forearm assume that the forearm is in the anatomical position, so it is supine. And since I've just talked about the upper limb, it is important to note that the term arm, commonly used to talk about the upper limb as a whole, in anatomy denotes just the part between the shoulder and elbow. The same is true for the lay term leg, which in anatomy indicates just the part of the lower limb between the knee and the foot, and not the entire lower limb. The trunk, part of the axial skeleton, includes thorax and abdomen. Compared to limbs, terms of movement have limited applications here, but another aspect of descriptive anatomy emerges, so-called reference lines. These lines are drawn on the surface based on the location of the palpable skeletal landmarks, and they are used in order to specify the location of the structures lying within body cavities. One way of referring to the location of abdominal organs, also used to describe, for instance, the site of abdominal pain or abnormality, is to divide the abdominal region into quadrants. To do this, we need just two perpendicular lines, and they intersect at the umbilicus. So they divide the abdomen into a right upper, right lower, left upper, and left lower quadrants. But the abdomen can also be divided into nine regions, defined by four lines. Two vertical lines that are called midclavicular, because each passes through the midpoint of the clavicle, and then a superior horizontal line, which is called the subcostal line, because it connects the inferior borders of the lowest costal cartilages, and the inferior horizontal line, which is called intertubercular line. It actually passes between the tubercles on the upper margin of the hip bone, and these are two points on the bone that you touch when you are told to put your hands on your hips. The three lateral regions of this grid, from upper to lower, are the hypochondrium, flank or lateral region, and groin or inguinal region. The three medial regions, again from upper to lower, are the epigastric, umbilical, and hypogastric or pubic regions. Obviously, you will hear and use these terms throughout your medical studies and practice, so make sure to remember and visualize them well. Now, you can use the following slides to review some common anatomical terms.